Good afternoon. I want to welcome you all to Central Park United Methodist Church, which is the spiritual home of the Heights family. Sasha was a young man when I first met him, a young teenager when I first met him. So it has been a privilege to be asked to be here this day. I want to begin with some words from Scripture. These are words that are intended to help us to heal from this great loss that we are experiencing. And the psalmist writes, "The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. The Lord heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Great is our Lord and abundant in power, whose understanding is beyond measure." Friends, we are here today to celebrate Sasha's life. I know that we come here with such raw emotion, powerful, powerful feelings of grief. But we also understand that God holds us in the palm of God's hand. God can heal our hearts. We will never be the same. We will be changed. But we are all the better for having known his love, this remarkable young man. So I invite you now to stand as you are able. And we're going to sing our opening hymn together. Please praise to the Lord, the Almighty, number 139 in your red hymnals.
Thank you.
I invite you all now to take a deep breath, to settle yourselves, your thoughts in this place. Bow your heads and hear these words of prayer. Eternal God, you know all things in earth and in heaven. So fill our hearts with trust in you, that by night and by day, at all times and in all seasons, we may, without fear, commit those who are dear to us to your never-failing love for this life and the life to come. Amen. I want to invite TJ and Michael to come forward now to share their remembrances.
Today, I stand here to honor and remember someone who deeply influenced not just my life, but the lives of nearly everyone present, Sasha Alexander William Heights. If we haven't crossed paths before, I'm TJ Lieberman. Sasha and I have nurtured a long-lasting friendship through all of life's ups and downs. But if you haven't had the pleasure of meeting me yet, Sasha would likely insist that you're the one missing out. Let's take a moment to absorb the room, to see all the faces touched by Sasha's life. Whether family, friend, or stranger, Sasha possessed an incredible talent for bringing people together and offering support. This was something he deeply understood within himself, evident in the artwork that he created. One piece in particular stood as a testament to this, bearing the inscription, "And I traveled deep into the abyss of what is, in order to hold the light high for those that had lost their way." Our friend also possessed an extraordinary gift for always being fully present in every moment. To this, I'm going to refer to something that has been able to bring me some great joy in this past week. Flipping through the guest book for my wedding, next to some crazy photos of him and Elle in the photo booth together, read, "Honored to be here and to see two of the best people starting the only journey that matters. Here for it. With all love and good vibes, Sasha." Sasha Mom, as Drew finally called him in our younger days, was truly there for everything, always embracing moments with love and positive energy. The reality of his absence may not fully make sense to many of us, but I'm certain that Sasha's spirit will forever be here for it, for all of us. Reflecting on this past week, I know we've all been revisiting the moments intertwined with Sasha, whether they brought joy or challenge, carried regret or happiness, involved actions taken or opportunities missed. All these moments encapsulate life's essence and are worth cherishing. Personally, all of these emotions have been swirling through my mind continuously. So I'm going to share this moment with you that happened to Sasha and I after he had passed away. Bear with me on this one. As I drove home, listening to our shared playlist, I found myself overcome with tears and emotion. It was a mix of anger and sadness consuming me over what has happened to my dear friend. As this is all going on, I'm speaking to him and finally tell him how sorry I am that I let him down and that I wasn't there for him. In that exact moment, a sense of relief washed over me. It was almost as if Sasha were seated beside me in the car. It felt as though he was there, reassuring me, saying, You didn't let me down, you idiot. There's nothing to forgive. Without a second thought, I was like that Sasha. I punched the air beside me as if nudging him in the arm, and just like that, my emotions shifted from anger and sadness to uncontrollable love, joy, and laughter, still while tears streamed down my face. I am sharing with you this personal moment to assure you, however you're grieving, it is okay to grieve. I strongly encourage each of you to find your own way to connect with him, to speak to him, to be present with him. Because as before, he's still very much here for it, for all of us, like he has always been. Before I go, I'd like to leave you with one of my most treasured characteristics of our Sasha. It was his ability to dance as if no one was watching. His ability to dance as if no one was watching, even if there was a line of people at 7-Eleven impatiently waiting to cash out behind him. The infectious nature of his free spirit, radiance, and endless joy has left a permanent mark on this world. To have been part of his life as he was a part of mine fills me, as I am sure all of you, with gratitude and unwavering pride. Thank you for allowing me this moment to share these words with you all. I love you, Sasha. Thank you.
Filled with the natural nostalgia of younger days. They're definitely colored by a very specific feeling that's unique to the person he was already becoming. I'd never met a kid my age with such a defiant sense of himself. He wasn't afraid of anything, which worked out because I was afraid of everything. His sense of humor, his sense of adventure, his sense for what was cool, these were all like something out of a movie to me. We'd be in third grade and he'd be talking about his favorite rapper or graffiti artist, and all I was bringing to the table were Doug Flutie statistics. He didn't have that much interest in that to my memory, but he stuck with it. I'll never forget the feeling that whatever we were doing, was playing in the Gus Macker tournament, or skateboarding badly, and messing around in his treehouse, it didn't really matter what it was, or how frivolous it was, because just by virtue of doing it with Sasha, it felt like some intrepid voyage, because he had that effect. Throughout our lives, the frequency we get to hang out would ebb and flow, but even in adulthood, I've been lucky enough to be his neighbor, dog-walking bud, coffee cohort at times, and even his employee when he co-founded a company and offered me a job. As a boss, he was as thoughtful and fun-loving as you'd imagine. Again, it didn't matter what it was. If it was with Sasha, it always felt like him bringing me in on some new adventure. I'm sure so many of you here today can remember something similar when you'd be talking to Sasha, maybe for the first time in a little while. He'd look you straight in the eye with a very Sasha smirk and say, "No, seriously, how are you doing?" And you knew he really wanted to know, not just to skip the small talk, but because he cared. I have no delusions about this being unique to me. It was just how he was. No matter who you were, he had time for you, and he was as good a listener as you could find. Someone with such an absolute aversion to boredom, whose heart was so filled with a drive to connect with the wider world and the countless experiences he wanted out of it. That person doesn't typically have room left over to be so caring and sensitive to the needs of others. It doesn't usually work out like that. But with Sasha, it did. His heart had room for both. It was incredible to see these attributes shine in him, even in the way he approached strangers. He had a way of dismantling awkwardness or uncertainty before the person even knew what was happening. Walking around downtown with him was like being with David Letterman. Seemingly strangers suddenly had ironic nicknames and elaborate handshakes. But these things about him shone even more deeply in the ways he acted as a loving son, romantic partner, animal lover, and friend. For me personally, his friendship felt like both a wild trip into the unknown and somehow also like home. In my mind, he's laughing at me and telling me how corny that last line was. It's the truth, and I love you, Sash, and I'm really happy and proud that I got to be your friend, and I always will be. Thank you.
I want to invite you all to join me in praying together the Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. It's my pleasure to introduce Barbara Heitz DeMong to all of you, Sasha's aunt.
Sasha's favorite aunt. It's an honor. I'm so honored that Drew and Bill asked me to pick a scripture or two. I can never stop at one. And to share a few thoughts with you. And so I want to just share that typically you hear this scripture at marriages. And when I was praying and reflecting on Sasha and all he did for so many, it was all about love, because that's who Sasha was. Sasha changed the lives of so many people. He was the light when he walked in the room. He was our light. He was selfless, kind, humble, loving, and he was always under the radar. He didn't need to be in, you know, on stage. Well, except for the dancing. He changed the lives of so many, but I just wanted to share that in my own personal family, he touched each one of my family. Laura, my younger daughter, in her 20s, she was disabled, but Crystal Lee and Sasha took care of and helped me with Laura for over a year. And Sasha would do the goofiest things to make her smile and to bring her joy. John, he just had a meal with John about 3 or 4 weeks ago. We sat at our kitchen table and they shared a meal. And just the two of them. He just wanted to hang out with Uncle John and help work through. And Andrea, my older daughter, who loved Sasha with all of her heart, they were hurt. They weren't just cousins, they were hard friends. And me, he was always there asking me how he could help, what he could do, how I was. So the scripture the first scripture is from 1 Corinthians, and it's chapter 13, verses 4 through 8. And think about these words as I reflect and think about Sasha and all he did for so many. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrongs. Love does not delight, but protects. It does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always preserves. Love never fails. My second scripture is from 2 Corinthians, and Drew and Bill, you're awesome parents. God just wants you to be comforted, and I know Sasha was the delight of your heart, and you did such a phenomenal job raising him, and his unselfish ways came from you, and you should know that and take comfort in that. He changed the life of so many people. So from 2 Corinthians 1, 3 through 7, praise be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ. If we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our suffering, so also you share in our comfort. Drew and Bill, thank you for sharing the life of your son with us. We are forever changed.
This is a reading from the Gospel according to Matthew, who must have been thinking of himself. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and talk to them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they prosecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the word of the Lord.
Will you bow your heads and pray? God, we thank you. We thank you for this community of men and women and children who have gathered here on a cold winter evening to be a part of something bigger than themselves, to say goodbye to a beloved soul, to take comfort in one another, and to be in your presence, God. We ask that you would guide our hearts and our minds. Help us, Lord, as we listen to the stories and we try to hear you always through your word. We pray that you will transform our hearts, that you will open us up to the possibility of a more abundant life. We pray, God, that your healing and your wholeness will be upon our hearts. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Almighty God, you are our rock and our redeemer. In about a half an hour or more from now, give or take, with the official setting of the sun at 4:55 p.m., it's not quite down yet, we'll mark the start of Twelfth Night, the culmination of the 12 days of Christmas, the grand finale of the Christmas season. And so tomorrow, the season of Epiphany, the season of light, begins with the story of a bright, shiny star high in the eastern sky, lighting the way, as the legend goes, for a group of foreigners, a group of astrologers. Perhaps they were kings. We know them as magi, seeking to pay homage to the savior of the world who had been born in a humble stable. At Epiphany, we move from birth to revelation, from nativity to manifestation. The mystery of God's presence on earth becoming known not just to a small group of people gathered around a stable, but indeed being known throughout the world. The mystery of God's presence became known to humankind. And let's face it, my friends, we could all use a little bit of revelation right now, couldn't we? A way of looking at the world and all of its troubles in a new light, a light that reflects God's compassion, God's boundless mercy, and God's endless love. And I believe with all my heart that that is the way that Jesus looked at this world, through a lens of pure love. According to Matthew's telling of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus saw the crowds that were assembled, and he went up the mountain in order to teach them all about God's miraculous love. These were ordinary people starved for a lack of justice. They lived in occupied territory. They lacked education. They lacked money even more. Their lives were hard and their lives were short. And their lives were full of suffering. The officials who held sway over their lives cared very little for them, except as a means for more riches and for greater power. They had troubles and misery that we can't even imagine, and yet here was Jesus in their midst, sharing their travails, listening to their stories, offering healing and compassion to the forgotten and the forlorn. Jesus understood the world as it is, with all of its corruption and its exploitation and its sin. Jesus understood the world because Jesus lived in the world. Not as a ruler, not as a prince, but as one of the downtrodden. Now, Jesus had no regard whatsoever for the wealth and the trappings of this world, because he understood that his throne was in another realm, another kingdom, another place and time whose rule is yet. No, it was the outcasts and the poor that attracted Jesus' attention. His message of God's coming kingdom was for them. Hope for the hopeless. Salvation for the suffering. Whenever the poor are ridiculed or ignored, Jesus weeps. Whenever the lowly are scapegoated or the powerful choose oppression over compassion, Jesus weeps. And wherever there is mourning, Jesus weeps. God has sent me, Jesus said, to bind up the brokenhearted, not the rich, not the powerful, not those whose lives come easily to them, not those who amass wealth in this world for their own personal gain. No, for the brokenhearted. Do not for one moment think that you are alone in your suffering, in your anguish, in your grief. For the blessings of his beatitudes are poured out upon the weak and the vulnerable precisely because of his experiences in this world. Jesus walked among us and listened to our human stories with compassion, without judgment. He chose to bless those who struggle, those who are afflicted, those who are without hope, those who are lonely, those who are old and sick, those who are struggling with mental illness, those who have lost someone dear. And my friends, this is God's great revelation to humanity, that God comes to us in the form of a baby at our most vulnerable. We discover power. In our most sorrowful times, we can see, even through tears, that there is always hope. And in the life and in the death of that same baby born in a humble stable, we understand that in death there is resurrection. In this season of Epiphany, this time of light and revelation and manifestation, my prayer is for the light that came into the world at Christmas, the light of Jesus that shines perpetually in the darkness, that that light will find its way into our broken hearts and bind them up. And Sasha, as you know, was a light bearer, bringing the message of hope and healing and sobriety to a vast array of suffering souls. We need more light bearers in this world. May his light live on in your work, in your service, in your commitment to love deeply, even in the midst of sadness and of loss.
I'm going to say a few words before I sing. My name is Andrea, and I'm one of Sasha's cousins on his dad's side. And all my cousins are boys, and they have never remembered very much. They always think I'm making things up when I recall the events, but I speak the facts. And the fact is that when Sasha was born, we were all so excited. I vividly remember fighting and arguing with all of my other cousins over who would get to hold Sasha and play with him and entertain him. Sasha and I had some wonderful times together locally and internationally when we traveled to Stratford, Spain, Greece, and Rome. As kids, we spent time together because of our parents. And as adults, we spent time together because we were friends. Although we were cousins, he was one of my closest friends. He had so many talents and interests and was such a cool guy. He was magnetic and fun and could disarm people quickly with his kindness and his wit. He could strike up a conversation and make friends with anyone, and I know you've heard that several times today. He was someone I always knew was in my corner and that I could call at any moment for absolutely anything. I imagine he was that person for a lot of people that are here today, as he was always willing to help anyone and everyone he could. We loved to play games, and I have many memories of silly and serious times. One of our favorite games that Sasha and I would play, he invented, was called the Meow Game. It's basically name that tune, but instead of humming, you say meow for every word. So example, happy birthday would be meow, 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 meow. We would play this for hours. Try it out for Sasha sometime. I guarantee you, you will for sure laugh and everyone around you will smile. Sasha and I helped each other through tough times and celebrated during great ones. My life is better for having had him in it, and I am so thankful for our time together.
Thing I ever had to a brother, and I just loved him very much and respected him. And he was an incredible person, and I'm going to continue to try to be like him. So I'll share this cottage prayer with you. When I die, give what's left of me away to children and old men that wait to die. And if you need to cry, cry for your brother walking the street beside you. And when you need me, put your arms around anyone and give them what you need to give me. Look for me in the people I've known or loved. Love doesn't die, people do. So when all that's left of me is love, give it away. Thank you.
Standing before you is the person you know best, but hides the person that you know least. And I know that we all struggle sometimes with things that other people don't know about. We do know that Sasha was a sober man when he passed. He was an active member in a fellowship that I too am a member of. He reached out his hands to everyone, again, love and service. He sponsored young men, he brought people into the fold, he got them sober. He lived a good life. What I know that I'm eternally grateful that he's touched my life in a way that I have so many stories, but I'll let others tell. And so far I've been affected by everyone's stories. But I do want to ask, please, of all of you, that when you leave here today, go about your lives, come into contact with someone who says, I'm fine, and they're fine, does it sound really right? It doesn't sound quite right. If they have a voice filled with pain, if they tell you, no, 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 I don't need help, please reach out. Please reach out and help and hug and hold when you can and who you can, because we all struggle in this world. A healing word and a random act of kindness goes a long way. God bless you all, be here in faith, and may God bless Sasha.
Space, a safe space, a place for yoga, art gallery, hydrotherapy all. We talked about plans to travel. He had just applied for his passport. We talked about Egypt, India, and South America. I told him, let's go to Patagonia. He said, well, do we have to wear Patagonia the whole time we're there? I learned a lot from Sasha's last couple months. I fear more than I was ever able to teach him. The concepts are not new to me. However, his approach is refreshing. How sometimes the best things we can do is just be selflessly present for others. The biggest takeaway recently was how he talked about forgiveness. I can tell you his passion to forgive others was fueled by his desire to hopefully one day earn the forgiveness of those he had felt he had failed. Sasha's passing has left many of us with a huge hole in our heart and a void in our life. What can we do now is honor him. So I challenge everyone to engage in conversation with anyone on the street. If someone asks you for money, tell them, hey, this is from my buddy Sasha. We would want you to have this. Or next time at a restaurant, when the waitress asks, what would you like? Tell her, I don't know, what do you think I should have? What do you recommend? Write down all your memories. Think about all the experience you had shared with him or things that you were going to do with him. And then tell his parents. Write them down so that they can do them. If you know Sasha, then you know how much he cared for, loved, and adored his parents. How much concern and worry he had for them. And continues to have. It's up to us to keep an eye on them. Drew enjoys movies, concerts, and exhibits. Bill enjoys billiards, golf, and walking the dogs. Know that you will never bother them with a call or text to say hello or that you want to check in. This grieving process will not be easy. Together, we can help each other through it. Most importantly, we will be able to keep Sasha's spirit and presence alive with us all. Standing here, I am sure he would say to all of us how much he loves us and that he will always be with us. And the last thing I'll say, similar to what TJ said, is an experience that I had after he had left. I told you how he called me Dare Bear. I did not like that name, but I never asked him where it came from. And I remembered how he would greet his parents and how he would bid them farewell. Hi, Mom Bear. I
Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. It's not elaborate. It's easy to memorize. I know you all know it. And so I invite you now to pray the Lord's Prayer with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. I invite you now to stand as you are able, turning your hymnals to 707, the hymn of promise.
Thank you. respectfully remind you, life and death are of supreme importance. Time swiftly passes by and opportunity is lost. Each of us should strive to awaken. Awaken! Take heed. Do not squander your life.
May God give to you and all whom you love God's comfort and peace, God's light and God's joy in this world and the next. And the blessing of God the Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this day and forever. Amen.